It leads me to think about modes for two classes of people. One class is the people who are in charge, the program manager, the ops manager, and then their safety team, their safety and mission assurance team. When you look at the concept of mishap prevention, as we go forward and we do our mission, one of the things that will help us accomplish our mission is if we do it without accidents. So it's kind of a key piece of it. And so mishap prevention is important, especially in human spaceflight. And the two modes that we tend to be in are, as I've labeled here, incident recovery or complacency avoidance. Just about everything we're doing in that area called mishap prevention can be put in one of those two buckets. I've asked people to challenge that. Tell me something we're doing safety and mission assurance right now, and I'll tell you which bucket it's in. Lessons learned stuff, that's in the incident recovery mode, really. That never goes away. Your lessons learned is about recovering from some other incident and applying it to what we're doing today. Complacency avoidance and incident recovery are the two pieces of the class that I went to. In 1972, I went to the Navy Monterey Aviation Safety Officer course. I was going to be an aviation safety officer in a squadron. And it was 6 weeks of accident investigation, because the safety officer is the accident investigator in a squadron. And then 4 weeks, the last 4 weeks, was on this thing they call mishap prevention. Now, as an engineer who's going to be a safety officer, the first 6 weeks, I really got a lot out of it. Now, it's a morbid thought that you're getting a lot out of accident investigation, but any engineer can go to that boneyard they have where they got the Grumman airplanes and the broken up helicopters and all that stuff, where they've laid them out in what they call the accident investigator boneyard at Monterey, and get just have a great time listening to these experienced accident investigators talk about what they see in the wreckage. And of course, the new guys don't see anything in the wreckage except just junk. It's like when you take somebody for the first time and drive them into the desert, and they've never been in the desert before. A desert person will be seeing all kinds of stuff, and the person that's not a desert person sees nothing, absolutely nothing, just waste. It makes you want to cry or turn on the air conditioner, or both. But once you know what you're looking for, and they show you what a fatigue crack looks like on a wing that actually broke because of a fatigue crack, and it's still there and you can see it right there in the boneyard, and they show you actuators that failed, they show you the causes of all these accidents as you go around, and then you do a lot of book work and so on, and it's good engineering stuff. And I really got a lot out of that. The 6 weeks went very fast. I won't say golf had anything to do with it, but the first 6 weeks was very interesting. And I thought any engineer would enjoy this course. Then the 4 weeks of mishap prevention, boy, that was tough. Totally different stuff there. It's all about things like psychology of the squadron, how you spot people that are starting to go south on you. The communications was a big theme. How you communicate mishap results is the easiest part of it, but how you just communicate on a day-to-day basis. Two human beings with different personalities, different motives, how they communicate, and in a way that they can be team members and wingmen or front and back seaters in an airplane and not kill each other. These kind of things were the softer sciences, and they were tough for guys like me and others in the class. It wasn't just me, but mishap prevention is very difficult, and that's not unique to naval aviation. So what's going on here? We've been in this mode here of complacency avoidance 90% of our time. This isn't meant to say number of hours, okay? Don't look at this as actual volume of work going on, but it's the percent of your work going on devoted to mishap prevention. Almost all your time is spent on recovering from that accident. And then as time goes on, you start coming off of that. You get to return to flight here, and then you're cleaning up a few items. Now you're working on the observations. Now you're down here working on the report that finally comes out on one of the related topics, like the crew escape study that we just came out and we're briefing around the agency. That's a incident recovery activity, but But these things are going way down when you talk about the Columbia mishap recovery. Now what we're talking about is this one here. Now how do we do that stuff? It's really hard. You got to use your imagination a lot of times to figure out how to keep people from getting into that mode that, you know, we've been successful. This guy here lived a long time ago, and he talked about how easy one of those modes is. It's actually easy for NASA to recover from a mishap, too. As hard as it is to have a mishap, and as much work as goes into it, we pretty much know what to do. We go investigate, we find problems, we test, we work on it, we know how to do it, we react to it, we go fix things, and we start flying again. And we can lay out schedules and work things like that. And it's kind of like this. But this one here is a little harder. When we've been successful, when we get out away from that accident after a while, you got to have some people around that are paranoid to help you remember that you could still have another one. Maybe that's one of the jobs of the safety people, is to be the village paranoid.